Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus said to his disciples, "Be watchful, be alert. You do not know when the time will come. It is like a man traveling abroad. He leaves home and places his servants in charge, each with his own work, and orders the gatekeeper to be on the watch. Watch, therefore. You do not know when the Lord of the house is coming back, whether in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or in the morning. May he not come suddenly and find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to all. Watch." The Gospel inspired by God. I was always kind of slow at the books, and so I didn't discover Joseph Campbell until 1986. It was a year I spent in London, and when I discovered him, I read voraciously. I was fascinated by what he had to say. But at one stage, I was reading one of his books, and I came across a statement that really, really shocked me. Probably one of the most shocking statements I've ever read in my life. But when I thought about it, probably one of the most true I'd ever come across. And the statement was this. He said, "The problem with Yahweh is that he thinks he's God." And it really, really rocked me. I mean, I dedicated my life to this Yahweh for the first 40 years. And he was saying, "The problem with Yahweh is he thinks he's God." So I began to rethink about this, and it finally dawned on me that this was one of the truest statements ever made. Because whatever about us being made in God's image and likeness, it is more accurate to say that we've made gods in our image and our likeness. And so Yahweh is a typical case. Yahweh was a God constructed by a particular kind of a theology or a particular kind of people. You know, and when you look at this God, I trawled the Old Testament after I heard that statement to try to create a quick overview for myself of what actually was what's the track record of this guy called Yahweh. What I found out was that he constantly made promises he didn't keep, and he made predictions that didn't come true. Again and again and again. And I'm going to give you a very, very quick synopsis at the beginning before I get into my material. And so, for instance, this God, allegedly Yahweh, made a covenant with a guy called Abram. And he brought him from Ur of the Chaldees, which would be modern-day Iraq, across the Fertile Crescent, into a land that he promised would be flowing with milk and honey, and that he would give to his patrimony. So Abram followed. Abram is 72 when he gets this call. He's not like he's a teenager kind of leaving home. He's 72 when he starts this safari. And he comes across the Fertile Crescent into this land flowing with milk and honey that God promises to him and his progeny. It turns out that it's not actually flowing with milk and honey, because there's regular famines. And so on two occasions, Abram and his wife have to go down into Egypt because there's a famine in the land flowing with milk and honey. And he goes back up each time. And then so Abram flourished about 1850 BC. In 1700 BC, his progeny all have to go down to Egypt because there's a huge famine in the land flowing with milk and honey. And they're enslaved down there, and they spend the next 450 years as slaves, from about 700 BC to about 1250. And then Moses sets them free. But for 40 years, they're lost. They're wandering in the desert, and they're fighting all kinds of battles with all kinds of enemies. And finally, they make it to the Promised Land. There's one problem. There's a whole bunch of people living in the Promised Land. So it takes them 200 years of warfare before they conquer the land, which brings us down to the time of David, about 1000 BC. David finally captures the city of Jerusalem in 1000 BC. But at that stage, the Philistines are problematic for them, so they're constantly fighting with the Philistines. That was a coastal tribe, you know, on the Mediterranean. And then in 930, there's a civil war. And the civil war divides them, and the 10 northern tribes of Israel secede from the two southern tribes based around Jerusalem. And they create the northern kingdom of what's called Israel, and the southern kingdom is now known as Judea. And they're at war with each other from 930 down to 721 BC. And then in 721 BC, the great Assyrian empire comes in, and it demolishes the 10 northern tribes of Israel, takes them off into exile, and they're never heard of again. They're wiped out completely. The southern tribes survive for 130 years, and then in 597 BC, The Babylonian Empire, which had conquered the Assyrian Empire in the meantime, came in and deported the last two tribes and flattened the city and destroyed the temple that Solomon had made. And now they're in exile again. The last two peoples are in exile. 529 BC, the Persians overthrow the Babylonians and they set the Israelites free to go back into the land. But in actual fact, only 24,000 chose to go back. A tiny little remnant go back. And as soon as they go back, they're now being ruled by the Persians. And then in 323, Alexander the Great marches across the Middle East, conquering all before him, and now they're under the hegemony of the Greek Empire. Until 187 BC, and there's a revolt, the Maccabean Revolt, and they wrest their freedom from the Greeks. But immediately, civil war breaks out. And there's this battle going on between two descendants of the Maccabees, each of whom wants to be the high priest and the king at the same time. So to settle the dispute, they invite the Romans in to adjudicate. And the Romans are very happy. Romans come in 70 BC, and they stay for the next several hundred years. And in 70 AD, the city is demolished for the final time, and the second temple is demolished, and the Israelites live in exile for the next 2,000 years, until the 14th of May, 1948, with the United Nations decree. So you look at the promises that this guy makes, this God of theirs, that he's going to make them his own special patrimony, and you look at his track record, it's atrocious. How anybody could put their faith in this guy, Yahweh, beats me. And all the predictions he made, none of them come true. All the predictions are false, and all the promises he can't keep. And so I began to realize Joe Campbell was onto something. The problem with Yahweh is that he thinks he's God. He obviously is not. He's some kind of a created divinity that really reneged on his promises or wasn't able to deliver on his word. So that's what I want to talk about today. And I'm going to make five main points this morning. So the first one I talk about, surefire predictions. And then secondly, I'm going to talk about this great reading that Susie did for us this morning, you know, the Testament of Adam. And then I'm going to look at predictions of the end times. And then fourthly, what do the end times really mean? And then fifthly, I'm going to try to unpack this parable of Jesus from the gospel. So that's what I'll try to do this morning quickly. So the first one, surefire prophecy. There's one gilt age guaranteed, 100% guarantee, that if you bet on a horse in a race, that you'll bet on the winner. So there's an absolute 100% guarantee you can bet on the winner. If you put money on every one of the horses. Yeah? You're going to lose a lot of money, but you're going to feel omniscient because you can show everybody, I had the winning ticket, I bet on the right horse. So if you bet on all the horses, you're bound to be right at some stage. Now, that's what happens so often in the scriptures. You know, this guy bets on all the outcomes. And when one of them turns out to be the winner, you can say, there I am, you know, I told you it was going to happen. So that's one way in which you can always, you know, be sure that your predictions will come true. Bet on all the outcomes. And one of them is going to come out, and you can flaunt that one. A second one, and it's not going to cost you a whole lot of money, it's not going to cost you any money. Instead of betting on all the horses stuff, you wait until the race is over, and then you bet on the winner. Yeah? And that's not going to cost you anything, and you're going to feel really omniscient, because you'll always have the winner. I don't know how many of you ever saw the movie The Sting. You see that great movie, The Sting, made in 1973. I think it was Robert Redford and Paul Newman. Yeah. And the part of the operation is the Union Telegraph is able to give the results of races on the East Coast elsewhere before other people are aware of it. And so people get the result, and then they bet on the winner, and they always win. So that's what very, very often, that's what prophecy predictions look like. If you bet on the winner after the race has ended, you'll always have the right outcome. Now, when you look through the scriptures are full of that kind of stuff, both the Hebrew scriptures and the Christian scriptures. In fact, when you look at the New Testament, and Matthew is particularly a culprit here. Matthew has a real penchant for dipping into the Old Testament, picking out totally innocuous statements that have nothing got to do with the Messiah, and then twisting them to prove that this was a prediction, you know, that the Messiah fulfilled. Matthew does it again and again and again in his gospel. And so very, very often the proofs of the Messiahship of Jesus Christ are based on texts, totally innocuous texts, having nothing got to do with even predictions of any kind that he will take and he'll work for his own advantage. So the surefire prophecies that we find in the Bible, you know, are a mixture of these two kinds. So I want to mention then this reading that Susie did for us. It's called The Testament of Adam. And I asked you to pay particularly attention to it before she began reading, because it's an extraordinary reading. So here's a book, you know, allegedly Seth being hearing his father. So you had Adam and Eve, and their first two sons were Cain and Abel. But Cain killed Abel. And so they had another son called Seth. And so Seth is the one that, you know, inherits from his father. And according to this story, Adam is about to die, and he's talking to his son Seth. Now, Adam lived to be 920. So he's talking to his son Seth, and he's telling him that when he got thrown out of the garden, God made a promise to him. And you heard what the promise was. In extraordinary graphic detail, he said, God is talking to Adam, and he's saying, I threw you out of the garden because you had made a contract with Satan and you ate the forbidden fruit, but you wanted to be a God like me, I'll make you a God like me. So I'm going to become a human being. I'm going to incarnate myself. And I'm going to be born of a virgin. And I'll even tell you what her name is. She's going to be called Mary. And it's going to be in a place called Judea. Now, Judea didn't exist at that stage. And in a little town called Bethlehem. Bethlehem wouldn't be built for thousands of years after this. So extraordinary specificity. And I'm going to have a normal childhood. I'm going to grow up, but I'm going to have extraordinary powers. I'm going to raise the dead, cure lepers, give sight to the blind. I'm going to walk on water. I'm going to calm the wind and the storms. I'm going to cast out demons. I'm going to be killed. On the third day, I'm going to rise from the dead. Extraordinary specificity of prediction. Amazing. It's an extraordinary document. And then we're told Adam died, and he's buried in a cave. And what's buried with him? He smuggled a few gifts out of the garden when he was thrown out. He smuggled out gold and frankincense and myrrh. And they're buried with him. And now Seth is making the prediction that when the Messiah comes back, wise men from the east will discover where Adam is buried, and they'll take the gold and the frankincense and the myrrh, and they'll bring it all the way to Bethlehem of Judea, and they'll find the child in the cave, and they'll give it to him. Now, is that the most extraordinary, you know, prophecy ever you've ever read in your life? Extraordinary. That with that kind of prediction, why wouldn't you believe? Imagine an audience in, like, in the medieval times, you know, before the printing press had been, you know, built, and they're hearing this story, and, oh my God, this is proof positive that our God is the real God, the real thing. He made all these kinds of predictions. When did Adam live? If you believe the Bible itself, the world was begun to be created on the 23rd of October in the year 4004. Bishop Usher, an Irish bishop, going through the Bible, could describe exactly when the creation process started. It started on the evening. It was a Sunday evening. Sunday, literally, it was a Sunday evening, 23rd of October, 4004. And Adam was created on the sixth day. So Adam's birthday is the 29th of October, 4004. If you want to send my birthday card, that's the day to do it. 29th of October. And so how did a guy who was born on the 29th of October, 4004 BC, how did he know all these things? Extraordinary. God was talking through him. There was only one problem. The Testament of Adam wasn't written after Adam died. It was written 400 years after Jesus died. It was written in the 4th century. And it was written, the extant copies we have are in Syriac and Arabic. We don't have copies in any other language. They're translated, obviously. But the ones that were discovered in the language called Syriac and language called Arabic. And they were written in the 4th century. And so they had 400 years, you know, after Jesus died to be able to predict all the things that were going to happen, you know, 4,000 years before he was born. And so that's the kind of the quality of the stuff you get here. Now, if you're a simple little, if you're a person living in the 5th and the 6th century, 1,000 years before the printing press, and you're part of an absolutely illiterate population, and somebody who's able to read produces this document and says, this was written by Adam, the first human being, and look at all the predictions he made, and your simple faith would be shored up. You wouldn't have the slightest doubt that you were following the right religion and you were in the right place at the right time. That's my second point. So when it comes to predictions then, my third point is this. There's a special subgroup of predictions having to do with the end times. In fact, there's a whole area of theology which is dedicated to this. It is called eschatology, from the Greek word eschaton. Eschaton means the end times. And there's an entire part of theology which is dedicated to this, the study of eschatology. And it talks about the end times, what happens at the end times. Now, you know, whatever about the other kinds of predictions, you can say with 100% accuracy, every single prediction of the end of the world, and there have been thousands of them throughout human history, they have one thing in common. Every single prediction of the end of the world has one thing in common. They're all wrong. There's not a single one that has, you know, come to pass. Yes, we continue to make them. But they've been made at every stage of human history, and they have one thing in common. They've all proved to be wrong, 100% of the time. So why would you put your faith in that kind of predictability? You know, if you want to be in the stock market with that kind of mindset, you're going to lose a lot of money. And so I just want to look at the New Testament for a few minutes. Whether or not Jesus said these things, I have no idea. I suspect not. But even according to Jesus, the end times were going to come, you know, while that generation was still alive. Jesus would say, famously at one stage, the things I've told you, there are some of you watching here, or some of you standing here, or some of you listening to me speaking today, this is Jesus talking, who will never see death until these things come to pass. 2,000 years later, hasn't happened. Paul is writing, and Paul is the first Christian writer. He's writing his letter to the Romans about 51 AD, which would be about maybe 20 years after the death of Jesus. And he writes two letters, particularly to a town called Thessalonica. They're called 1 Thessalonians and 2 Thessalonians. And in 1 Thessalonians, he's telling his audience, you know, wherever you find yourself right now, don't make any changes. It's not worthwhile making changes, because Jesus is coming back on Tuesday at 10:30. It's imminent. So if you're married, stay married. If you're not married, don't bother getting married. You know, don't change your trade. There's no point to make any changes, because Jesus is just about to come back. And so about 3 or 4 years later, he has to write a second letter, because nobody's going to work anymore. I know he's a new rule. He says, I realize that, you know, in my first letter, I said to you that don't make any changes. But I've heard since that there are some idlers among you who are refusing to go out to work. So my new rule is this. If somebody doesn't work, he shouldn't be eating. Don't give food to anybody who refuses to work. So Paul has to change his tune, because he's totally convinced that Jesus was coming back imminently. But the most predictions happen in the Gospel, or the Revelation of John, the Apocalypse of John, written about 100 AD. And particularly the last three chapters, chapters 20, 21, and 22, are full of dire predictions about the end times and the beasts and signs in the sky and wars, you know, and the pit of hell that people are going to be thrown into, and a general judgment. Really, really devastating times. And John makes the claim in that letter that these things are soon going to happen. Now, the problem with all of these predictions is this. There are five things being conflated, five different issues all being mixed up together, and it is very difficult for us to figure out, you know, what are they really talking about? So let me extract the five of them for you. The first one is, they're talking possibly about the fall of Jerusalem. The second one, they're talking about the end of the world. The third one, they're talking about the second coming of Jesus. The fourth one, they're talking about individual death. And the fifth one, and this is my favorite, I claim, is talking about individual awakening. But they're all mixed in together. So you look at when these Gospels are being written. Mark's Gospel, the first written, is 70 AD. That was the year that the second temple was finally destroyed. Judaism rebelled against Roman occupation beginning in 66 AD. Now between 167 BC and 132 AD, that 300-year period, there were 32 armed rebellions in the land of Israel against occupying forces. And of those 32 rebellions, 31 of the 32 began in Galilee, where Jesus was from. So Galilee was always a hotbed of revolt. And in fact, the life expectancy of a Galilean male at the time of Jesus was 29. So Jesus actually, you know, pushed the envelope a little bit if he lived to be 33. So there's constantly revolt. So there was another revolt in 66 AD, and they actually held out for 4 years. But at the end of 4 years' siege, Jerusalem fell, and it was destroyed, and the second temple was demolished, and it has never been rebuilt since then. And so this is when Mark is writing his gospel. So he's surrounded by this kind of devastation. 4 years of warfare have resulted in the annihilation of the people of Israel, the destruction of the temple, the end of priesthood, the end of sacrifice in the temple. So it looks like, as far as he's concerned, it looks like it is the end of the world. And so there's the fall of Jerusalem, there's the end of the world, and he's convinced then that Jesus is coming back. So all these things are being mixed into the equation. So when you're reading the gospel accounts about the end times, it's very hard to kind of pick out what did the writers intend, and if there's a message from God, what is the message from God? Because obviously the world did not end at any of those times predicted. And so how do you extract these pieces from the puzzle? Which brings me to my fourth point. What does it really mean to speak about the end times? And here's my hit on the end times. The end times is not a prediction of the end of planet Earth or of our cosmos. It's not, you know, about the annihilation of Jerusalem, which happened 2,000 years ago. It's not about the second coming of Jesus, as if there's going to be some kind of a cosmic event with signs in the sky and Jesus kind of floating down to Earth, you know, as some kind of an extraterrestrial. It's not about that. It is about the awakening of the self. So I'm going to make three sub-points here. The first the first coming of Jesus Christ was when you were conceived and agreed to incarnation. So there's my very favorite passage in all the Christian scriptures is from Paul's letter to the Philippians. It's in chapter 2 and it's verses 6 to 11. And here's what Paul says. He says, have that mindset in you, in yourself, that was also in Christ Jesus. Because although he was God, he did not cling to his divinity, but he emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in human form. He even accepted death on a cross. And because of this, every being on heaven, on earth, and under the earth will bow the knee at the name of Jesus, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now, the church promotes this, you know, as worship of Jesus, which is interesting. But they neglect the very first statement. The very first statement is, have that mindset in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Because that's exactly what you did. Every single one of us, every single human being, at some stage, you know, self-emptied. We were in God's presence. We were a beam of light from the sun, which is God. And every single one of us volunteered for incarnation. We self-emptied, just as Jesus did. And that involved taking on all kinds of limitations. We had the limitation, we who were cosmic creatures, we now find ourselves confined to these tiny little embryos in a womb. We who had cosmic consciousness are now operating from this tiny little laptop that we carry between our ears. We who existed in the eternal now are now subject to chronology and time. And mostly, we who were aware of our divinity and the divinity of all other beings are now, we have total amnesia for who we really, really are. And we think we are our bodies, or we think we're the jobs we do, or we think we're, you know, the relationships we're in. And so every single one of us, and there's a word for this in Christian mysticism, it's called kenosis. Kenosis is the self-emptying. It is the divinity within us emptying itself in order to experience a human incarnation subject to all of its limitations and learn how to love anyway. And so that's what the second coming of Christ looks like. It was your arrival. And then every single one of us is meant to birth God during this incarnational experience. There's a very strange phrase that we find in Luke's gospel, where speaking about the Father, Jesus says the following. He says, you must be compassionate as your heavenly Father is compassionate. Now, Christ would have been speaking in Aramaic, and the word for compassion in Aramaic is the word rachamim. And rachamim is literally the plural of the word for a womb. And so here's Christ saying, you must be womb-like as your heavenly Father is womb-like. Now, part of the problem is that the word that's translated into English as father, you know, is more accurately translated from the Aramaic into birthing principle of the universe. It's not a gender-specific noun. It is much more like it is that which gives birth to all that is. So the Father is literally just the birthing principle of the universe. So here's Christ saying, you must be womb-like just as the birthing principle of the universe itself is womb-like. So when you think about what does womb mean? Womb is that faculty which is able to conceive, carry, and give birth to life. And it can do this sequentially. It's not just once that it does this. It can do it many, many, many times. And so Christ is enjoining us to be birthers. And so first we give birth to our physicality by saying yes to incarnation. Then we give birth to our ego. Then we give birth to our relationships. Then we give birth to, you know, the jobs we do. And Christ says, keep going, keep going, keep going, keep giving birth until you give birth to God. And Meister Eckhart would say this very powerfully in a great Christmas homily 600 years ago. He would say very famously one time, of what use to me is it that my Savior was born of a virgin 1,300 years ago? If he's not born again, in my time and in my heart, every single one of us is meant to be the mother of God. And we literally are. Every single one of us who have self-emptied and, you know, divested ourselves of divinity in order to embrace incarnation with all its limitations are meant to give birth to God during incarnation. And so the real meaning of the end times is not even your personal death. The personal death comes many, many, many times at the end of every incarnation. And we'll sit down with some kind of a heavenly mentor and we'll review the progress we made during the incarnation and figure out what's still left to be done. What do you need to do when you go back in order to move further and further into love? And so the real way in which we give birth to God is that the self-realization during incarnation that there is only God. That's ultimate. That is the ultimate end times. And that is the ultimate second coming of Jesus. It has nothing got to do with the cosmic event. It has to do with the realization, while still in incarnated form, that there is only God. And now you can give birth to that realization, and then Jesus has already come. So with that in mind, I just want to unpack then the parable from the gospel. And the very simple parable was that Jesus says, be watchful. Now, in this very short passage, it's Mark's gospel, chapter 13, is five verses, verses 33 through 37. But in those five verses, five different times, he uses the phrase, be watchful, or be alert, watch, be alert, watch out, five different times. So it's all about being watchful, which was the name that the Buddha gave himself. The name Buddha just literally means the one who is awake, the one who is watchful. And so Christ will tell this parable, and he's given various different versions of this parable 9 or 10 times, you know, in the scriptures. And it's basically the same outline. And it is that a man was going on a journey, and he put, you know, one of his steward in charge of all his property, who was in charge of, you know, his property and the other servants, and he went on a trip. But it's not known when he's going to come back. So when he does come back, better that he find you watchful and awake. So how do you unpack that then, in light of the first 4 points? So in some senses, the man who goes on the journey, elsewhere in the reading he's called the Lord returns, so the master or the Lord or whatever. The Lord is the soul. It's not God, it is the soul. And the soul volunteers for incarnation. But incarnation, in some senses, is a journey away from home. It's a safari to some other place. It's a safari into physicality. Whereas our real home is source, it's God's presence. And so this master is on a journey somewhere. And the journey is, you know, incarnation, away from source. And during this journey, he puts a steward in charge of all his property. And who is the steward? The steward is the ego. The steward is the kind of that aspect of the psyche which is responsible, you know, for the dealings of our physicality and our relationships and the work we do. And who are the servants? The servants are all the faculties and the gifts we were given for incarnation. We were given physicality, we were given emotionality, we were given intellectuality, we were given personality. We're given all these as the servants. And they're all meant to be at their work, trying to kind of honor the Lord when the Lord comes back. And the Lord will come back. And the Lord is the soul. And the soul at some stage realizes, okay, you know, we finished our mission this time round. Now it's time, you know, to leave and to really, really go back home. And so the understanding then is that the journey of incarnation is a way in which we test our ability to be aware of our divinity even when we have subjected ourselves to kenosis and to self-emptying. Can I disidentify with my ego? Can I disidentify with my relationships? Can I disidentify with the job I do? Can I disidentify with even my thoughts and realize that at the core, I'm just a bite-sized piece of God having a human experience? Disidentification does not mean dishonoring. There's a reason why we incarnated. It means honoring incarnation. It means honoring the body, celebrating relationships, being faithful to the jobs that we were called to do, but never getting identified with that, always realizing that we're souls on safari on planet Earth. We're spirits in spacesuits. We're bite-sized pieces of God having a human experience.